So actually we are in our learning outcomes or objectives actually in two, objective two, design and implement various image transforms. And we studied last time point-wise transform. Now today we are studying geometric transforms, image transforms. So what are these things? Let's see, you may be taking a picture of some object, some scene element like this one. This is a license plate, right? It's just cropped, of course, from an image of a car. So let's say your viewpoint was a little bit tilted, right? It's not possible to always view the image from up front in a straight way, straightforward way. So this is the, this left one is the image you took, let's say. You see here some geometric transformation effects, right? Normally I will ask you what kind of transformation effects you see. You would be saying maybe rotation and the perspective transform, maybe projective transform. And actually there is also affine transform. Here what we are doing is trying to correct this geometric transformation. Why? Because again, remember the goal of our class, we are trying to teach the computers, right? Teach the algorithms to see, to be able to gain the ability of the human visual system. And here the goal of this picture is obviously to be able to read the letters, right? The characters in this license plate. So, and of course there could be like a zillion ways of taking this picture from different viewpoints, different lighting conditions also. That's where the intensity transformation comes into play. But here now we are focused on the geometric transformations. They in a way create some kind of distortion actually. Say they are distracting us from our goal, right? So that's why we try to estimate those geometric transforms and we try to undo those. Here in this case, we try to estimate here first, let's say a rotation. You can see obviously the plane rotated here. And we do here a affine transform correction because we want in the end this license plate to appear in this rectangular form, right? Because from here, it would be more robust or at least more meaningful for our algorithms to be able to capture these letters or these numerical characters and letter characters like 95D37825. Okay, so our learning objective is geometric learning, how to model geometric image transform and how to implement them, design and implement various image transforms. Specifically this week is geometric transforms, okay? We see this geometric image transformation problem in many different fields. For instance, in medical imaging, patient comes into the, for instance, MR machine, MRI, magnetic resonance imaging device. You have a MR scan taken, and maybe next week or 3 months later, you have another scan. If you overlay those two 3D images on top of each other, this you get, these are three different viewpoints again, like for instance, axial slices, what we call slices from left to right, for instance, and slices from, for instance, bottom to top or top to bottom. So here, let's look at this one side view. This is called sagittal view. You see when you overlay the two different images, image volume scans, of course, we are looking at the slice, or here in the axial view, you see the mismatch, right? Geometric mismatch. Normally we should be, what we call registration or geometric matching is to align these two images and either 3D, 2D, or this is also generally called data alignment problem. So what you are learning this week helps you register or align data sets, okay? And there is also non-rigid, rigid forms. We will study some parametric forms today. For instance, after you align these two coordinate spaces. This week, our transformation is on the coordinates of the images, not the intensity of the images. That's the main difference. So that's why sometimes we call this coordinate transforms. Okay, so you see when we align these, for instance, two volumes you see at the bottom now registered, or we register them now, or actually maybe I should show it like this. Now they are on top of each other as much as possible, of course. Okay. Another, for instance, geometric transform problem is something we call this lens distortion effect. This happens with cheap cameras, wide angle, especially wide angle cameras. With your smartphones, you are taking pictures every day. Maybe you've seen this effect. Even if, for instance, you see straight lines, this is a corridor from a building, right? And look at these lines of the walls here, okay? Do you see this curvedness? It's all curved. Normally we are expecting straight lines, right? In especially buildings, man-made structures. This effect is called lens distortion due to some lens aberrations. It's due to the optical characteristics of the camera. Especially we see it with wide angle lens cameras. And I'm sure most of you have noticed this once at least when you took pictures of especially like buildings and straight structures like these. You can also probably see it in the horizontal horizon line and other lines in the nature too. So we have to devise a geometric transform, model this transformation or distortion and undo it. This is called in camera calibration, lens distortion calibration. So we try to fit these curved lines actually, or bring them back to these straight lines. You see the transformation we have to go through, right? It's a what we call actually a polynomial transform. We will see it today. It's a polynomial transformation. And don't worry about this, because these are just the curving of the boundaries of the image. It's fine, but actually the main thing is the valid part of the image. You see these walls and lines are now straight, corrected. So how is this done? Typically we obtain a grid like this, and we take its picture and we try to map it back to lines actually. And we will see at the end of this week's lecture, if we can finish, we can do it next week, finish it next week. We will model this lens distortion through a kind of a polynomial, second order or fourth order polynomial transformation. So these geometric transforms are, they change the spatial position of pixels or the coordinates of the pixels. They are maybe called image warps, but it's better to call them either geometric transforms or coordinate transforms. And like we already given examples, they try to bring multiple images into the same coordinate system. It's registration, or in 3D vision, we try to do this by taking pictures of the same scene from different viewpoints. And we try to align those pictures to be able to estimate the estimate some information about the projective transformation of the 3D view. We try to remove distortion, lens distortion, like I just said. And there are other uses, image morphing, morphing, warping, we will see today in stereo matching as well. You see, for instance, we may correct this here, the transform in this image. We may rectify this image in this way. This would this is making the main planar plane in the actual scene straight or orthogonal to our viewpoint. That's the idea here. Okay. So here is the definition of the geometric transforms. Let's say the X, let's call this pixel X. You see this is a transformed image, or let's say this is the image you took, perspective. Of course, this is synthetically transformed, but let's say this was the image you took, and you have a pixel point here. It has an intensity, of course, but here you see we are mapping actually the coordinate, the pixel coordinate X. Let's say X is the position here. You see it here, map your coordinates, T of X, right? Then with T, this function or functional mapping, geometric mapping, we will map x to x prime. You see, I find the same feature. This is the side of the mouth of Mona Lisa. And I know it has been mapped through a transformation T to this point, x prime. Okay. So our goal in this lecture is to write these mathematical models. X prime is Tx. And we want to estimate T. Okay, that's the goal. And once we estimate T, then we can map the images actually. You see, this is, there is no image involved here yet. This is just a mapping or transformation on the coordinates of the image. Now, after we get T, we can insert here, for instance, X prime, replace it by T of X. So J of T of X is equal to I of X. So we can do the image transformation as well. We can carry the intensity from here to its destination. Okay. This is the definition of geometric image transformation. You can, of course, this was on purpose a created transformation, a deformation like this, swirl transform. It had some cosines, sines, exponentials in it. I just made it up and called it to show you this. We have to move the pixels here. What it's trying to say is by mapping and resampling, but there can be such non-linear deformable transformation. So there is a source image, there is a destination image, okay? So you will be, at the end of this lecture, you will know how to carry out such transformations, or maybe let's start with a simpler transformation, because these are parametric transforms, much easier to represent. And here it is a rotation, right? So first we have to define the coordinate mapping, like I said, describe the destination for every location in the source image, let's say UV. Destination is XY. I mean, these names, I'm using these variables interchangeably. So just be careful, just know which one is the source image, which one is the destination image. Destination is the transformed image, okay? Source image is being transformed. So let's say you rotated by 30 degrees. Of course, you will use here your theta should be in radians, right? Not degrees, but I just kept it here 30. So here is the mathematical definition. We will see this again, but you would map the source coordinates uv to x through u cosine theta minus v sine theta and y using u sine theta plus v cosine theta. And you would get, when you insert 30 degrees, it's counterclockwise. There is a convention you should have to check, counterclockwise or clockwise. And here you should also define a center of rotation. We will see this too. Here in this case, the center of rotation was here, 0, 0 at the bottom left. That's why you see the picture rotated from that center, okay? But if I define, for instance, the center of rotation as the center of the image, we would see a different effect. A general coordinate mapping, because these are parametric transforms, we will see there are non-parametric transforms. A general mapping will be like this. Give me a source coordinate uv, I can define actually any function of uv. Of course, it has to still satisfy some criteria like smoothness. It has to be continuous at least, right? But then smooth, with nice smooth, maybe differentiable actually function of uv, I can get these interesting transformations actually. So now let's discuss forward mapping or backward mapping versus forward backward mapping. So forward mapping is this. You have a source image, its coordinates are given by uv. You have a destination image grid actually, right? It's a grid to grid transformation. So you have a destination grid xy. I'm trying to actually rotate, for instance, or transform the source to the destination. The forward mapping does this, iterates over the source image. So go to each of these pixel coordinates and rotate them. You see, again, please always remember here, we are really rotating or transforming the coordinates of the image, okay? So for instance, here is an xy. I would map it through this mathematical rotation transform. And let's say I would find that it is mapping to here. What is the problem here? Do you see here some pixels may not have intensity values, may be left without filling actually. Some destination pixels may not be covered. It may happen covered. It may happen that many source pixels can map to the same destination pixel, and then actually we would not have a uniform coverage of the destination grid actually. That's the problem here, guys. So in practice, actually, we never, almost never use the forward mapping in our geometric transforms. What we do instead is we use backward mapping. That's why I was talking about the inverse transform, okay? Meaning, I would this time start from the destination image grid, okay? Place your destination grid X, Y, use the inverse transformation, okay? T inverse here, it would be, if it was rotate by 30, it should be here rotate by minus 30, of course. I mean, if we are talking about guys, this one, okay, it was rotate by minus 30. Okay, the because we have convention of counterclockwise, okay, now the inverse transform of rotation of by minus 30 degrees is rotation by 30 degrees, right? So now, this time, the nice thing is I iterate over the destination pixels, okay? And I now go back and try to see, for instance, where this guy, this XY point, if you see my mouse, is coming from, okay? So I must then, why am I going back? Because I will have to resample the intensity value at that point, okay? I will be then resampling intensity and placing it into the destination point where I started from, okay? So, like it says here, we prefer backwards rather than using forward. So we will use T inverse. So this one, this slide shows actually the disadvantage of forward mapping very well. You see, for instance, if it's a scaling up transform, okay, scaling by a parameter greater than one, you see I would have empty pixels here. There are gaps in my destination grid. This is my destination grid, this is my source grid. But if I started with here, with the destination grid, okay, and if I went back with the T inverse to find, for instance, where this guy is coming from, I will interpolate in between, okay, or I will be sampling from the same point. It's fine. At least I will be filling everybody. So inverse mapping ensures no gaps. Okay. However, it's necessary to interpolate, of course. We will see that. So I will actually then skip this. It's trying to say the same thing because it's forward mapping and not used in practice. I've just seen it. This is just another slide showing the same idea. Now we are really implementing this backward mapping now. Always please pay attention to the names of these coordinates. Whichever I'm or you are naming the destination, whichever you are naming the source is important. So let's see. Inverse transform maps this X prime Y prime on the right hand side to X Y on the left hand side, the source image. Okay, because I want to sample from the source image. So you start in the destination image pixel, you go back to the source because you want to sample the intensity value in an interpolated way from there. Okay. Exactly, it says here, use the colors of neighboring integer coordinate points in I to estimate I of P, okay? Typically, we will use bilinear interpolation. There are other versions we will learn soon. So our final actually mapping is I prime, the destination image XY, X prime, Y prime, its coordinates should be equal to, this is the assumption, I of XY, right? But I know XY can be replaced by the inverse mapping H inverse. So actually this equation equivalently becomes I prime at x prime y prime location equals I of h inverse x prime y prime. Okay. And there is no round of error, which is our advantage. Okay, so I'm trying to see, this is giving the code. Here is some Python code with OpenCV again to be able to, this is actually implementing a rotation transform. Okay, how to do this? Another way to show it mathematically or in a pseudocode way. So start from the destination image. Here it's named UV, doesn't matter. You should just know which coordinates are destination, which coordinates are source. That's it, okay? Here destination is named UV. So I iterate over UV, okay? And I then find the corresponding XY, you see, in my source image with TX, T inverse T UV. Here is the important thing. Now I obtained floating point XY. I need to resample my source image I at those points XY to get the intensity values, interpolated intensity values for my destinated image, destination image. And because I will copy that J of UV, this guy into the UV, okay? And we are using the backward transform. I hope this is clear. That is the idea. Now I will tell you how to resample also, how to interpolate these intensity values. So now let's look at the gray level interpolation. We will learn about different geometric mappings after we study now the interpolation. Again, it's showing the same thing. This is my destination pixel, right? This is my source pixel, XY. UV are the destination pixel. We call the source image I, the destination image J. We are trying to fill J, remember? And we have T inverse. Now the problem is when we map UV by this inverse transform, X and Y are coming in floats. They are real numbers. So we know that our images are in digital grids, right? So we don't really have that I of X float, Y float, actually. Guys, you see the problem now? Because this, I'm saying map UV by inverse transform to XY, but actually it's not mapping to the center of the grid. It's mapping to this floating point location, X, F, Y, F, let's say. I just said float, X sub F, Y sub F. This is question mark. What is I of X, F, Y, F? This is the interpolation, image interpolation problem, because we have real coordinates, not integer coordinates here. What are the straightforward or the two interpolation techniques that come to mind? First one is nearest neighbor interpolation. That is actually the easiest one. Maybe you've seen this before. Gray level of the pixel UV is actually taken to be not UV actually. I'm reading here, but actually the XY that is closest to XF, YF is taken to be the pixel location here. Okay, so now we said the basic or most straightforward interpolation will be nearest neighbor interpolation, right? So I would just round in a way, round these XF, YF to the nearest XY and sample my intensity from there, okay? That's the nearest neighbor interpolation. We will see a bilinear interpolation, extension of linear interpolation to 2D actually. The key idea will be to perform linear interpolation in one direction, then again in another direction. Okay, so let's see first the the nearest neighbor interpolation. Neighboring use the closest actually integer coordinate points in I to be able to map R intensity, okay, to the intensity from I, sample from I actually to J. That's what we did. Okay. Now let's actually, this is very easy. I'm not spending more time on it. Probably you already understand the idea. Now let's look at the other one. This is the second one. Okay, this is, slide is again repeating the nearest neighbor interpolation. Like I said, you had real numbers except yf, and now instead of them, use I of xy. Okay, the closest integer coordinate value. Okay, this is, I think, very simple. I hope everybody gets it. Of course, here there are rounding off errors, right? But let's look at bilinear interpolation. Here, this time, it uses actually the distances to the four neighbors because we are in a 2D grid. Let's say, assume this is a cell, grid cell, right? And my floating point xf, yf, the coordinates, real coordinates, fell into a place like this. It uses the distances to its four neighbors. You see floor neighbors and seal, floor and seal, you know, the mathematical operations, x, y, and x plus one, y plus one. And of course, there is the other two neighbors, x plus one, y, and x, y plus one, right? So it uses these four coordinates, you see, x, y, x plus one, y, x, y plus one, x plus one, and y plus one. Samples the image at those locations because they are grid locations. I have the intensity values. And then scale all of these, in a way, actually do a weighted combination of these, but according to the distance. Now I will open this up here, blow it off so you can see better. The idea is measure my distance, xf, yf, distance to the actually floored coordinates x and y. So that's the base of the, in a way, grid location x, y, you see, and everybody else is defined with respect to that by increments of one. Now name or say the distance in the horizontal direction as a, distance in the vertical direction as b of my real value to these points. Now use these in mapping my intensity. And here is the idea. You see, let's say this was really closer to the floor coordinates. So for instance, this was, I'm just making up some numbers now, 50 and 60, let's say, the grid point xy. And this was, then this would be 51 and 61, right? And then this could be then something like 50.2 and 60.3. You see, it's closer to the floor coordinate. So then I would assume that for a good sampling, actually, from these intensities of these four neighbors, I have to weight inversely. So because these inverse to the distance, actually, and this comes out of a mathematical bilinear interpolation formula, but I'm showing you the intuition. It's important to understand that. So if A is then 0.2, I should use 0.8, actually, 1 minus A, to sample the intensity value from I and do the same. B was 0.3, now use 0.7 to sample from IXY. So 0.8 times 0.7. Similar here. Now let's look at maybe this end. They are farther away from the diagonal neighbor. Now I use 0.2 times 0.3, okay? So this is the actually very simple bilinear interpolation formula. This is typically almost always used because nearest neighbor interpolation is too easy, lots of errors, round of errors. It leads to these jaggedness or contour-like features in image transform. So you see, in our geometric image transform, we also have an intensity transform, but that's just to sample the intensity value at the source grid location, okay, or coordinates. It's details for those interested because it's called bilinear interpolation. This is a bilinear functional mapping from xy to I of xy. So you see I have four parameters and it's linear in both its arguments. Okay, and its four coefficients are chosen so that IXY fits the known values at the four corners, meaning here is my pixel. I will use ix, let me see, I will use i00, i10, i11, and i01. Here they just named the, you see the floor coordinate and seal coordinate as 00 and 11, but it's the same as I wrote. I wrote xy here and x plus 1, y plus 1 here. So you linearly interpolate in the horizontal direction, okay? Here you see ix0, you interpolate. Then you interpolate ix1 in terms of these four points, four corner points, okay? These f, don't get confused, they are the image intensity values. Now vertically interpolate this time, okay, to get ixy. And in the end, if you actually insert everybody from the previous equations into this equation, exactly what you get is the bilinear equation, which I showed by labeled by stars two slides ago. It's the equivalent, actually. You can rewrite it and show that. You are not responsible from this derivation, but you may be curious how we got this final result. I mean, some naming convention is different, but they are the same. In the end, they end up being the same numbers, because I named A, B. Here it's named X and Y, guys. That's why. Okay, here is X. And then the Y distance is also here. So, let me see. No, here is X and here is Y. So here is my A, which is named X. Here is my B, which is named Y here. That's the only difference. If you insert or rewrite these equations with those symbol changes, it's the same equation, okay? So here are some results from an old textbook, you can see. Let's say this is the original image to be transformed. It's just a rectangle, dark rectangle on a bright or white background. It's rotation. It's showing the difference between rotation with bilinear interpolation top row and rotation. The bottom row shows rotation with the nearest neighbor interpolation. Okay, so it's showing rotation with different degrees. So this was 45 probably, right? And this is a rotation around the center. Looks to me, these are different rotation angles. You see the difference. Maybe let's just compare this and this, or this and this. You see the jaggedness, right? Because we are here doing a rounding of the coordinates, we will see these jumps in the intensity value. So it won't be smooth. Bilinear interpolation is always smoother. There is also bicubic interpolation. Here, this one is showing us another example, another geometric transform example of this small cat here, Tom, right? This is Tom, I think, from Tom and Jerry. This guy is being scaled up, right? This is a scaling transform, enlarging five times, three different interpolation techniques. This is nearest neighbor. You can see the effect we've just seen in that simple example, right? All these contouring, actually, rectangular contouring at the contours of the image, which is not nice. And bottom left, this is bilinear interpolation. I think it's quite good. This is bicubic, going one mathematical level higher, polynomial, but typically bilinear interpolation is used. But these are also available in OpenCV and other libraries you can use for computer vision. You can choose bilinear or bicubic, but like I said, bilinear is typically enough. You may ask this question. When we do this inverse mapping, sometimes the pixels fall outside the image. What to do there, for instance? So actually, maybe before that, I think we've seen that example. It's a little bit back, but here it was showing this effect. For instance, you are trying to bilinearly interpolate. You go back by inverse transform. It falls out of the image grid. There is no value here, actually, to sample from. We say put zero, actually. We fill in zeros for all these non-available intensities. So in the end, some darks, the blacks may appear in our image for missing source intensity points. It's fine, or intensity values. So pad zeros or constant values, you can also, this is trying to say, I was saying pad zeros, you can also replicate your image a little bit, wrap your image around, but this is typically not done much. We typically pad zeros or constant values at the boundaries. So here we go to parametric geometric transforms. I was asking what would be the transformation from this input image to this destination image here? What would you think? Any answer? I mean, it's a shift, right? We call it translation. So it would be, let's see, the actually the u is x minus, okay. Actually, let's look at this one. This is forward mapping, this second line. X is u plus 20. Take the source at 20. I mean, easier to understand in the forward. Y, let's see, this should have been y, by the way. Y equals v plus 30. Sorry, there is a typo here. This y should be on the left-hand side, v should be here. So y is v plus 30. So you see 20 shift on the horizontal, 30 shift on the vertical, right? And I can easily find the inverse mapping, right? To do this mapping, to do this interpolation, to sample the intensities, I need the inverse mapping uv. U is x minus 20, v is, you see, I would go here and go back by this transformation. For instance, x is 0, x minus 20 is minus 20. You see, I'm outside the grid. U is minus 20. So I fill in zeros. You see what I'm saying, right? Here at this point, top left corner at this point on the right image, let's say it's 20 by 30. So if I insert x is 20, u is 0, exactly here, top left corner. And y is 30, so 30 minus 30, v is again 0. So I would sample this intensity value and bring it here. This is the idea. So now let's look at some geometric transforms, okay? So here, I've already defined it. We will some parametric transforms, parametric geometric transformations. So here we have a set of parameters. For translation, how many parameters do I need? 2D translation. It's two, right? Two parameters. So I need to define x0, y0, the translation or shift amount. So this is my straightforward definition of the translation. Shift each coordinate by these two parameters. But I can also write them in a matrix vector multiplication form using something called homogeneous coordinates. So I would append my 2D coordinates by a 1 at the end as the third coordinate. And using this actually helps me to represent my geometric transform, which is given here in terms of two equations, as a simple matrix vector multiplication. You see my destination coordinates are written as x, y, 1. This is their homogeneous coordinate representation. This is the geometric transform matrix. It's a linear, shown as a linear transform here. And this is my source coordinates. You see, as soon as I define x0, y0, I can do this inverse map and find my source coordinates, okay? This is translation. So let's look at rotation afterwards. First, let's see, this is again repeating what I just said. This is the translation transformation T written as a 3x3 matrix, okay? And we apply this to our homogeneous coordinates of the destination and obtain the homogeneous coordinates of the source coordinate, okay? Or source grid. Here is a Python code to do that, okay? Doing this matrix vector multiplication. Okay, before rotation, let's look at the scaling transform. It's 1 over S, for instance, because if we are doing forward scaling S, Now by the for the inverse scale UV inverse transform, I need 1 over S. So S is here the forward transform. This is the scale transformation. You see, I need to put, this is uniform scaling, S to both X direction scaling and S to the Y direction scaling. Now this translation is zero because there is no translation, okay? And again, I may have a more general version of it, non-uniform scaling. I can have SX and SY, two different scale parameters to map my image, scale my image. That's also possible, okay? So, by the way, always you have to think of your center of transformation in a way. If you want to make your center the center of image, you can actually subtract the center coordinates, do the transform, then bring back the center coordinates, okay? Image center. If you want to do your transformations according to the image center, you should always normalize the grid, image grid, with respect to the center coordinates. So for instance, let's start. This is a question. I'm giving you now this transformation matrix. You see it has scaling 2-2, so it's gonna enlarge. And it has translation by 2-2. It was unit square, meaning 0-0, right? 1-0, 1-1, 0-1. Actually, it would translate into this square. You see my center of actually transformation or wherever my center was, now it's actually at this point, at the top, bottom left. Always keep this axis, center of axis in your mind when doing these transformations. Similarly here, this is a rotation transform. So it has actually 2D rotation, has one parameter you have to define, plus the center of rotation, of course, you need to specify. This is the rotation, 2D rotation matrix in the planar space. So theta is in radians, let's say pi over 4. And we apply this rotation transform and obtain this rotated image. You see these black areas, those are the ones I was telling you before. There are no corresponding points. So remember how to do this mapping. You would start from the destination coordinates. From here, you would iterate over this, just one by one. And for instance, I'm here. I would go back. I would not see it would, this guy when transformed back by the inverse rotation, it would fall out of the image grid. That's why I have zeros here, okay? So for instance, what is the center of rotation? What was selected as center of rotation here? It was the center of the image, right? Okay, and here 2D rotation requires one parameter since it is only rotating on the image plane. Can everybody see the rotation, center of rotation, visualize it here? I mean, if my center of rotation was here, it would be a completely different rotation, or if it was here, it would be completely different. Okay. This is rewriting the same thing. And you see, I'm using, by the way, homogeneous coordinates, okay? And UV are my destination, source pixels, sorry, XY are my destination pixels because I'm trying to do a backward mapping, okay? Okay, so exactly does a rotation by theta degrees, okay? So here, okay, I'm giving you this, rotate around a given center of rotation. Let's say I'm given x0, y0, subtract it from the coordinates. Actually, we could have inserted this x0, y0 here, right? Because I know this is translation, this first line. I hope you all can see it. That minus x0, minus y0 should go here. Minus x0, minus y0. Now I centered my image. Then I do the rotation in a way, or do them together in this way, and then come back at center of rotation back. Okay, so this is, you see, mathematically what you would be doing. Computing inverse of the transformation matrix for translation, it's really minus, right? Because you're shifting by plus, let's say, take the negative of the shift amount. For rotation, this is a inverse rotation matrix. You insert minus theta actually, because theta minus theta into your rotation matrix. For scaling, it's 1/scale factors. You need inverse transformations because you need to do for a backward mapping, right? We said we have parametric transformations. We can compute forward and backward transforms easily in this nice 3x3 matrix form. And we could obtain this 3x3 matrix form by the addition of this last dimension, last coordinate, which converted our both source and destination coordinates to homogeneous coordinates. Now we have translation, rotation, and scale. This is non-uniform scale. Of course, by the way, I have to note that, okay, this is 2D rotation, meaning I am on actually the image plane, right? On the projector plane or on your screen. But this is then still a 3D transform, but it's actually on the planar space of this image plane. But normally I can talk about rotation about 3 coordinate axes, right? So maybe you can think of the transformation that we are talking about here. If this x here, look at these 3 coordinates, okay? These coordinates here, 3 x, y, z. Assume x is coming out of the picture, okay? So x is coming out of the, I mean, the plane, the screen to you. Then actually this rotation we're talking about is around that axis, okay? Because it's really what we're doing as 2D rotation is staying on the projection plane, right? But I could have done rotation like this or rotation like this. I hope, try to imagine these in your mind, picture them in your mind. So you see this third one, the one coming out of the picture is the one that we were talking about. I mean, the X is coming out of the picture, but the rotation stays on the picture plane, okay? But in this course, we are only responsible from this, the third one, guys, this one, or similarly this one. I mean, you see, in order to represent then those 3D coordinates, we would add a fourth dimension. This is 3D vision material. Then coordinates become 4D, and matrices become 4x4, okay? But here we are in 2D, so we go one dimension up and we work with 3D coordinates. So for instance, if I ask you now, what happens to the image by the above transform? If this is the backward transform, we go to source image, we come by the forward transform by the inverse of these. Because C and D are greater than one, this is a shrinking transform because I'm giving you the inverse transform, okay? Okay, what about C and D? Either less than one, or if they are negative, there will be actually some reflections. I think I have a question like that coming up too. But here, an important transformation that we will learn is the affine transform. I will also later make these non-zero, but first, imagine until now, look at these transforms we looked at. Here I had identity 2D transform. Here we had a specific form of 2D matrix, right? Cosine, sine, sine, cosine, or we had scales, zero, zeros. Now, see, we are making these four numbers actually A11, A12, A21, A22 numbers. Okay, now we have actually this affine effect, also called shear effect. You see here, what is happening is the parallel lines still stay parallel, like these two guys were parallel, horizontal and vertical lines, but they are shear. They have this skew effect, skewed towards both X and Y skew. You see, as in here, Of course, here this guy, this transform here was around the center of rotation of the actually, or center of the image. So this you can imagine where the center coordinates, but I'm showing 0, 0 here. You have to play with these actually to see exactly their effect, to see what is happening. So here, then what has happened is my grid, which was a rectangular grid, actually the image's own grid, of course. The again, our matrix in our computer program is this matrix, which has all these blacks into, but our image, which had its own borders as a rectangle, now became a parallelogram. So you can notice the affine transform effect from a rectangle becoming a parallelogram. Okay, this is called affine transform. Now, most general form of affine transform, you see I'm also making the translation coordinates non-zero. So I have how many parameters? This is another parametric transform. Translation had two parameters. Rotation had one parameter. Of course, I would always need to specify center of rotation. Scale had, uniform scale had one parameter. Non-uniform scale has two parameters. Now I have affine, general affine transform with six parameters, okay? So you see it's the mathematical form as represented here. X prime is equal to A11 X plus A12 Y plus A13. So A13, A23 are like, again, a shift, right? You see also, again, with this last dimension, help of the last dimension, I am able to write affine as a nice linear, in a way, transformation matrix. Actually, it's this transform is nonlinear in its own natural dimension 2D, but it's actually when we represent it by this 3D or extended homogeneous coordinates, now it looks like linear, which is nice. Okay, so yeah, I mean, in OpenCV, obviously you have these ready transforms, right? For instance, warp affine, but again, here in this course, we prefer you to do these on from scratch. And generally, we name this matrix, the whole 3x3 matrix, as A matrix for the, to represent the affine transform. So these are vectors. X prime is equal to A times X. 3x1 vector, 3x3 matrix, 3x1 vector. So now let's look at, actually, these other transforms we've seen until now are special cases of the affine transform. Just look at this transform and now see. Replace A11, A22 by 11, the other two off diagonal 0, 0, and just leave the translation. It becomes translation. Replace A11 and this 2, A22 by these corresponding trigonometric functions. We get the rotation, and similarly zero out everything but just keep the two diagonals, then we have scaling. Okay, you see affine is a, in the hierarchy, more general transformation. So this is a special case, but this is a affine transformation. We can keep only one of the off diagonals non-zero, the other one zero. Now this introduces a skew only in one direction. Okay, so you see now it's a skew in the horizontal dimension has been skewed, right? Here, S is 0.5. So this is a skew in this dimension. You see, I could have had, if S was in the other way around, I could have this skew also in the other way. So for instance, let's look at this transformation. Exactly now I have the skew in this direction. How would you expect it? Now you see the skew is in the second axis. You see the difference between the two, right? The skew of this horizontal dimension, the skew of the vertical dimension, okay? For instance, if I include a negative, I have to give you a hint. There will be a reflection, guys, because there is a negative in the these x direction, you see there is a reflection, a symmetric reflection around x axis here, or in this case around the vertical axis actually, right? Here typically In our conventions, first dimension is the vertical, second is the horizontal, but always check in your own programming environment. This is very important. These are very simple errors we make sometimes. Confusing X and Y, which one is horizontal, which one is vertical dimension, because then we wouldn't get the effect we want, right? Okay, so this introduces a reflection around in that case, around the vertical dimension, the first dimension. So now let's look at this example I've shown you in the beginning. The license plate example, these pictures, this is the Ireland plate, because I remember these slides quite past, in the past, they were from my friend, colleague, Greg Slabo, from City University of London. He is in Huawei now. That's why it's Ireland, Irish plates. Now, these pictures are, from him. So this is, remember, this is, let's say, my input image. I'm reading the license plate image. Okay, height and width. Okay, you get. Then you get, you see a rotation matrix. Here you see, guys, in the OpenCV, you define the center of rotation. Width over 2, height over 2, that would be the center of the image. Center of rotation is defined as the center of the image, and it's obvious actually from here to here the transformation is really affecting from the center, right? So it's really turning from the center. So we will rotate clockwise by 15 degrees to align the base, meaning to bring these base horizontal lines of the plate straight as I would want with the horizontal axis of my plane. Okay, I can do it with this minus 15 degree theta angle. Now apply SQ, apply this, let me see where is my transform. Okay, transform is here. It's 1.300010. So you see the skew is 0.3. Okay, now apply this transform. You get a rectangular image, as we would have straightened image, rectified image. Here is the question. How do I get these parameters? That's the thing that we will study now. Okay, that's important. Exactly. Estimation of the parameters. Now let's start with a more general transform, affine transform. Let's try to get directly, actually, you see, from here to here, right? Or let me see. Yes, exactly, actually. You see, skipping this bottom, this or middle step, let's try to go from the input image to the affine transformed final image. Okay, what we would do? We want to determine the six coefficients in the A matrix. So estimation of the transform here is really estimation of the parameters of the matrix, transformation matrix, because this is a parametric transform. Okay, so we would need to determine correspondences, meaning I would know, for instance, these four corner points, or it could be other feature points in my image. I know P1 on this top right left corner maps to Q1 in the destination image, P2 maps to Q2. I need to know also minimum number of points I need to pick. To estimate six coefficients, how many point correspondences do I need? You can think of it in this way. Each equation or each point correspondence gives me two equations, because there are two lines in the matrix, remember? That gives me two equations. So I would at least need three point correspondences, but typically we get, due to all the, of course, uncertainties in the locations of these points, we get more points than needed. So at least three correspondences are enough, but these should be matching points. By the way, in computer vision, this is another big problem of study, how to get matching points or correspondences. Because they are the ones, they are very important. This P1, Q1, P2, Q2, knowing these gives us a lot, tells us about a lot about the 3D structure of the scene. For instance, even here we can start by estimating the affine transform between the two coordinate spaces. But in this course, we until at some point we assume those correspondences can be picked manually. In your second homework, you will work on this. Say you pick four correspondences, so you can just go by a mouse operation, pick P1 and Q1, of course, label them accordingly as correspondent, P2, Q2, P3, Q3, P4, Q4, okay? That gives me 8 equations. Now set up the equations, okay? Let's say these were the numbers, by the way. Now set up the equations, okay? These were my affine transform. I have homogeneous coordinates, P and Q. These were P and Q, remember? Okay. And in this 3D space, it's a linear transform. I mean, it's already, we've said that. So now I have, let's say I collected, let's first just use 3 correspondences, okay? 3 points. So it's X prime, Y prime, and X1, Y, but 1, 2, 3. So you see X1, Y1, X2, Y2, X3, Y3. I can rewrite or write or insert all these equations into actually matrix vector multiplication. Okay, so let's check what is happening here. We said, okay, we said this, right? We said I have an image and another image here. And of course there was a finally, maybe I could have done it this way. If this guy, we're trying to bring it to these coordinates, P1, Q1, Q2, P3, Q3, and P4, Q4, right? Okay, so we have these correspondences. So P1, Q1, and actually these guys are vectors, right? Because we're doing coordinate transforms. So let's say it was X1, Y1, and X1 prime, Y1 prime, okay? So I have also P2, Q2. So it's X2, Y2, and X2 prime, Y2 prime. And actually I could have N of these. I mean, it could have been a structure with more correspondences. I could pick here, even I could, maybe if this was a one here, I could pick this point to be P5, okay? Here it's P5. So I could go all the way to PN, QN, N points. There is a minimum number, of course. X prime, XN prime, YN prime, okay? So let's maybe go to two. What was the affine transform? We said it is really X1 is equal, or X1 prime is A11 X1 plus A12 Y1 plus A13, and then Y1 prime is A21 X1 plus A22 Y1 plus A23, right? This is the equation for the first pair. Now I have, I can write this for all the points A11, this time X2, right? It is mapping its own corresponding point. Y2 plus A13, and now let's write Y2 prime, which is A21 X2 plus A22 Y2. You see the same equation. Now this is mapping the same equation, geometric transform is mapping the second point and all the way up. Now let's see all the way down actually to Xn prime, Yn prime, A11 Xn plus A12 Yn plus A1, oh this is 2, 3, A13, A11, right? A21. A21 Xn plus A22 Yn plus A23. Is it clear? So this is now the set of equations, right? Actually, we have six unknowns. So it's really a, these guys are overdetermined set of equations, right? So I was telling you linear algebra is very important for computer vision. This is overdetermined. This is a system of linear equations. And I assume you guys know how to solve this. What are the unknowns here? Unknowns are, don't say x and y because they are measurements. We know them. Unknowns are a11, a12, a13, a21, a22, a23, right? These are the unknowns. Unknown parameters. So we are actually trying to estimate these parameters. Parameters to be estimated. Equivalent. Okay, so now let's set up a matrix vector multiplication because we know how to solve such from our linear algebra. We know how to solve such systems of equations even if it's overdetermined. So convert the set of equations into this form. I have unknowns. This is my unknown vector. So I can, okay, let's change. I can make, first of all, I would be like, hey, let's bring the unknowns here. Because these are what I'm after. A11, A12, A13, A21, A22, A23. This is my 6x1 unknown vector, and this is actually what you have in your x. There will be an a equal to b, let's say. So this is my x vector. Don't get confused. I just wrote ax equals b, this because this is from your linear algebra. But here, don't get confused. This x vector is the parameter vector, but in our, until now, in our formulations, x was always the coordinate, so don't get confused. Now let's write the measurement matrix or coefficient matrix, right? Here it is. Let's just read it off from here. Whoever is multiplying x, A11, it's all X1, X2, Xn, right? So easier thing is actually first write the B in the equation. I can see B's are the left-hand side in this case, right? X1 prime. I can also just maybe arrange first x's then y's. So this could be x1 prime, x2 prime. I mean, it doesn't matter, but this would look, this looked easy to me on how to arrange the A matrix. Then I go to, you see, y1 prime, y2 prime, yn prime. Now you see this is this was 6x1 parameter vector. Let's maybe don't write x here. This is my actually a parameter vector in this case. This is 2n/1, right? This is the, in linear algebra, the b vector, but here it's our observations b. Now let's write a, the big a. X1 prime is x1 plus y1. Actually, it's not, yeah. Y1 and 1, right? And I need for these guys, actually, zeros here for the first guy, 0, 0, 0. Now I need for the second X2 prime, second equation. X2 prime, read it off. It's X2, Y2, actually, it's the same pattern, right? 0, 0, 0, until Xn, Yn, 1.
Olur tabii.
What's that? Yes, but already no. Now there will be a shift for the y's. A21, right? Now it's 0, 0, 0. And like you said, it's the same. Actually, we could have solved this as two equations, two separate set of equations. But I just wanted to show it together. I have this, right, for the y's now. X2, y21, 0, 0. 0, xn, yn, 1. And again, and this time, this is has to be 2n/6 matrix, right? This is my A matrix. You have to write your unknown matrix here, right? I'm trying to form this here and from here, actually, how do I solve this? How do I solve this? I have to say, I know you guys will say, because this A is 2m by 6, or it could have been the half of it, it's fine. 6 by 1, right? This is 2m by 1 over determined system. How do we obtain the result? This is actually what we're trying to do. This is not exactly the same. This is really actually, because these are measurements, right? In here, I have measurements, observations. So this is the unknown. But here, actually, don't get confused. This is A. Maybe let's keep this as A, little a, parameter matrix, affine parameters. So here, what we do is we set up a optimization problem, okay? For instance, I would say let's minimize because I want a minus b to be almost zero, okay? So try to minimize then their difference, okay? Minimize their difference. I can show you how to derive this, but in the end, remember our a turns out to be a transpose a inverse, what you guys call a pseudo inverse, but I can use, I have to use pseudo inverse of A. You can take the inverse directly. If you used only three correspondences like I was showing, I think, Cenk, what you are saying is in the slides. We will see, go back. But if you collect more points than needed, you need to do this, right? Because you need to really use pseudo inverse as A is rectangular. You can't invert it, right? You can take an inverse of it. I mean, A inverse doesn't exist. That's the problem. You see what I'm saying? Right? You would have to definitely use this form of solution. Let's see. To be able to go. Yes, we can take the inverse. You get it. Exactly. That's why you need to go through this way. Use the overdetermined system of equations, and you should also maybe try to see how to go from here this minimization to the result. Maybe for this time I can skip it. In the past years I was showing how to take the derivative of this, and you would have to really write the inner product there, ax a minus b transpose a minus b. This is our minimum optimization problem. Of course, we are after argmin, but then I would need this guy, a transpose minus b transpose. I mean, you would have to open this up and then minimize it, right? A transpose, a minus, you would have to come up with a transpose b, and I can maybe make this, they should be equivalent, plus b transpose b. Minimize this with respect to a, you would end up with, guys, exactly to a transpose a minus 2 a transpose a transpose b equated to zero. So take the derivative, and that's how you get actually exactly this result of pseudo inverse. Okay, from here pull this guy, because this is a square matrix. Now I can take its inverse, it's invertible, hopefully. I mean, with reasonably good measurements, this guy becomes invertible. Okay, it also, at least theoretically, it's invertible because it's a square matrix. That's the idea, okay? It's derivation. Here, take derivative with respect to A. Of course, these are matrix vector derivatives, so you should be careful. That's how you get A equals A transpose A inverse A transpose B. Okay, so now this would give us our parameters in the end, okay? So maybe let's go back to our slides, and let's see what we have here. I mean, you can really arrange these in different ways. Here you see this slide set derived it in a mixed form, this M matrix. It called it M, this observation or measurement matrix. I was writing the first doing the X equations, then doing the Y equations. Here it's actually writing them in a mixed way, X and Y, you see? So, but I mean, all of them amount to the same thing. And the idea is in the end, we get A equals the pseudo inverse. But here in this case, it's a 6x6 matrix, 6x1. We can take the inverse. But if you have more than three correspondences, we have to really go with the way I derived it. Similar here also, of course. You can go with the pseudo inverse here. Yeah, I this slide is empty because I will also upload my derivations, what we just did in the notes, handwritten notes, don't worry. This is, I think, also another set of derivations similarly, just to keep them in the slides. It's the same thing doing X and Y or U and V separately. So I won't redo it. And here is again what we did in the slides, in the notes, sorry. So guys, if affine transform is clear, there is one more step we can generalize. One more step we can go to generalize this. A parametric set of equations through this 3x3 matrix, it's projective transformation. Now we can remember this was a 0, 0, 1 line row. Now we can make it also numbers. This gives us, we are getting somewhat closer to the perspective transform. Here, however, there is a catch. To obtain this perspective effect, we do this transform, and then we have to get rid of this last dimension. Remember, because we are in 2D image space here, we divide the first two coordinates by this third dimension. That's why actually this last one brings nonlinearity to the picture. We don't call projective transform a linear transform. We can still try to obtain its parameters through a similar formulation as we've shown in affine, but here then at the end it becomes a nonlinear transformation. Here this time we have how many parameters? 8 parameters, so we need at least 4 correspondences. Okay, and perspective effect is exactly, always remember when somebody talks about perspective or projective transform, it's always this rail tracks, railway effect, or this perspective effect of lines converging towards infinity, right? Even if they are parallel, when we have a perspective camera, projective camera, and that's typically what we have, we obtain by taking the picture of such a rectangle, we obtain effects in this way, right? These perspective effects, actually. So here is a nice example. For instance, you can say, ask, find the best projective transform, actually, here to transform the game area. Here is the game area, game console area, in Atari Saloon, let's say. This is the original picture you took. Here you can see this perspective effect exactly on this plane, right? It's a trapezoid, actually, like looking. So a rectangle becomes a trapezoid, but we know in real world, this is a rectangle. So we use some prior information in a way. So I know then this is, I have to model a projective geometry here. You can try an affine transform, but you see it's not working. It's not doing what I want. In the end, if you used those 8 parameters and do a projective transform, you would get the effect you would want. Okay. By the way, I think in a few minutes I will wrap up. We can continue next time because you will have a short quiz. So perspective transform, we said, could be even generalized generally in this way. Set of linear equations, though, let me see. I think there is one degree of freedom that we have to fix to one. Let me see. It's a nonlinear transform. Yeah, this A33 should be one, guys, because we want to, let me see, keep at least the degree to 8, because I need 8 parameters. everybody, when divided by their last coordinate, these guys will end up being one. So yeah, this slide just generalized it to 9 parameters, but it should be 8 parameters. Okay. Anyways, I already mentioned this. It's a nonlinear transform because we have division by the last coordinate. I mean, it's exactly saying the same thing. Okay. So hierarchy of transformations. Now we completed the whole set of actually equations. This first one set we've learned actually is called rigid body transformations, 3 degree of freedom, meaning there is a translation and rotation. Why is it rigid body? Because it's really not changing the shape or area or any length here. It just translates and rotates. It's still staying as the same rigid object. Similarity transform takes it one further away or makes it a little bit more general. Now there is scale introduced. S. It's now scaled. It could be rotated also. Okay, it could grow or shrink. Now affine transform, remember, has 6 parameters. It has the last line as 001, but it's A11 to the translations. Actually, we've named, remember, TX and TY as A13, A23, but it's the same thing. Only parallelism of lines are shared. This is the most general. You see, I get trapezoids now. It has 8 degree of freedom, meaning 8 parameters. And I would have to go through or go over these 8 parameters. Typically, guys, this is a 3D vision topic. In an introductory computer vision course, this is not covered much. So we typically also work with these 3 transforms. So don't worry about this, actually, if you are not very clear, but still ask, of course, and try to understand it. So this would be the hierarchy. This rigid transform is also called Euclidean transform. Then when you add scale, it's a similarity transform. One further in the hierarchy is affine, and lastly, you have projective transform.